My dad owned a high-screen Colani PC like this one here back in the days. However, he was really into OS2 for overcoming memory limits, which was, naturally, a bad thing for me, as it hindered me secretly running those DOS games I wasn't supposed to be playing anyway. My solution back then was to bring in a multi-boot setup between DOS, OS2 and Windows, because it was not about playing games, but all about compatibility. So let's get into replicating my multi-boot setup from the good old days.
It's obsolete technology no one uses today, but I'll bring it back to life. I'm the vintage collector and these are my stories. In order to install DOS and OS2 for a multi-boot setup, one can go multiple routes. In the most simplistic case, one would simply create a primary partition to hold MS-DOS and an extended partition to hold OS2. I, however, always prefer to have a primary partition each for MS-DOS and OS2, so only one OS partition would be visible at a time and the two would not interfere. Either way, for a multi-boot setup, one has to boot into the OS2 installer first and run FDISK from there. This is as important because you need the OS2 boot manager installed up front, which as well needs its own primary partition. Booting into MS-DOS setup right away would typically just create a single partition, leaving no room for OS2. So I'm creating the boot manager partition and a rather small first primary partition to hold MS-DOS. I'll then leave the OS2 setup, not installing OS2 yet, but heading over to MS-DOS. After installing MS-DOS and booting for the first time, I'm also installing the CD-ROM drivers for that Sony CDU31A drive you saw in my last video. Since MS-DOS doesn't know anything about OS2's boot manager, I have to make the boot manager partition the default active partition again. Only on the next reboot I'll then get to see the OS2 boot menu. I'll then quickly install some additional tools like Norton Commander and the Norton Utilities. The latter is important as it brings SpeedDisk, which can defragment the drive, a discipline which is largely forgotten these days. As the default MS-DOS install is not very optimized, I'll tune the config.sys and autoexec.bat startup files to ensure not only DOS is loaded into the upper memory, but also providing UMBs to load drivers high. Also, rewriting the statements to either device high or load high makes sense in order to provide more memory to applications below the 640 KB barrier. I'll then quickly head back to the OS2 setup, creating an additional primary partition for OS2 itself and an extended partition to hold Windows and the DOS and Windows applications. As a fact, my dad owned the exact same machine like this one back in the days. And for some reason, I never threw the originally installed CDs away. So here they are, serving again their original purpose. Windows will auto-detect the network card in this machine, though I'm skipping this for now until I return to the networking topic. Although Windows will detect existing MS-DOS utilities and add them to the program manager, I'll head out for the MS-DOS setup again to properly register its native Windows utilities to the program manager as well. Apart from that, I'll be installing Microsoft Works, but also these other software packages, Organize and Waze for Windows, which were bundled with the high-screen machines of that period. As a fact, I also got myself this original Mouseman from Logitech from around 1993. We actually did have a similar Mouseman, but the cordless model, but for now, the wired mouse will also do. Adding the Logitech mouseware also loads the DOS driver, though as basically no one cared, drivers were just loaded into conventional memory. So I have to tweak around a bit with the configuration again to conserve as much base memory as possible. And as you can see, as I had 680k free at the beginning, then dropping down below 590k, I could bump it back up to 610k. However, it goes not without saying that this needed some reordering of the drivers in which sequence they load. and still after doing so, I didn't manage to push up everything into the UMBs, leaving still some drivers in the conventional memory.
Why are you doing this all manually and not using Microsoft MemMaker?
Because I'm actually quicker at optimizing it myself and I want to show off Microsoft MemMaker at a later occasion. Still, even back in the days, many people questioned as to why certain drivers had to be that huge, like Logitech's mouse.com eating up 20 kilobytes of RAM. And instead of only trying to squeeze out as much as possible from the UMBs, some things are better, like replacing the drivers by another one, like here, CT Mouse, which only eats some 3 kilobytes of RAM. Why? Because when adding the Sound Blaster drivers, memory starts to fill up again immediately, requiring for yet another optimization run. Speaking of drivers, Windows didn't recognize this BRV7 Plus graphics card, thus it runs only in standard VGA mode. I got myself these drivers here, which give me 800x664K of colors and even 1024x768 with 256 colors. I'll go with the 800x600 resolution and 64,000 colors. Now, you may have wondered as to why I installed Windows first. The answer comes with the OS2 installation. OS2 was offered in two editions, the Red Spine and the Blue Spine boxes. They are basically identical except for the fact that the Red Spine was cheaper as it didn't include a full copy of Microsoft Windows. The Blue Spine was more expensive as it came with its own copy of Windows. The Red Spine edition could actually install so-called WinOS 2 on the fly, however, if there was already a pre-existing copy of Windows installed, OS 2 would modify it to run an OS 2 as well. Now, the neat thing with my partition layout is that this already installed copy will continue to run on both OS 2 and MS-DOS, so essentially I end up having a shared copy of Windows. This comes in handy as it helps conserving disk space. However, sharing the install brings some problems along, like here on Windows Startup. There will be some complaints about the Logitech mouse driver unable to start from WinOS 2. Or the MS-DOS utilities group here, of which the programs are inaccessible because the primary DOS partition is hidden. While this is just annoying, there's actually a good reason to introduce a small batch script, which can swap a set of configuration files whenever Windows is run from DOS or OS 2. On one side, for the OS 2 version, I create a copy of progman.ini, which doesn't have the DOS-specific groups. I'll also create a copy of win.ini, which doesn't load the Logitech mouseware utility. And while I include the batch file in DOS's autoexec.bat to have the file swapped on startup, I'll just register it with OS2 startup group to do the same here. While it's not utterly necessary, it's just something that makes it a bit more seamless and less annoying. Sharing the Windows installation between two operating systems has its price. And it's a bit conflict-free, especially when either of the two environments have to inject specific and potentially conflicting device drivers. I'll then also install some applications for OS2, like IBM Works or the word processing software AMI Pro by Lotus. Now, here's a little something I always tweaked, as when you're looking at the drive icons in the launchpad, you can't easily tell which drive it is. But OS2 comes with a built-in icon editor, allowing me to quickly alter the drive icons to make it less ambiguous which hard drive partition it actually is. Another thing I still need to care for is the OS2 graphics drivers. Because, as you can clearly see from this blur, the desktop currently runs in 16 colors VGA mode. Now, you've seen me installing the Windows graphics drivers already before. Actually, it took me quite a while finding the correct ones, as again, most sources have vanished into obscurity. And while I did find many different driver versions, most were for the previous OS2 2.x or didn't include high-res drivers for Windows. Basically, there's just one set of driver disks, which include both the matching Windows 3.x and OS2 warp drivers to go along and enable high-res mode for both. Having said that, they also have to be installed along each other, as we see here in the setup utility asking specifically for the Windows driver disk. Now, the story could be over here had the setup utility not always failed with obscure errors on missing files. Of course, silly me, my first choice was to ignore it and just reboot, only to find myself being greeted by a crash dump. Luckily, this can be easily recovered from simply by pressing F1 while the small OS2 in the upper left corner is shown. This will provide a recovery option to reinstall the default VGA drivers. Well, so I went again to search the same driver release in the hopes it would be complete. Though, no matter what, even if I found another copy, it was obviously always the same defective one. I then eventually went on to inspect previous driver versions if they had the missing file, but to no avail. It took me a while to realize that it was actually more than one missing file this setup utility would complain about. Actually, it would be two, and two each different ones for every resolution chosen at the very beginning of the setup. I stumbled across this when learning that a PMI file is actually a Super VGA configuration file, which can be created from OS2's DOS mode via the SVGA command. So my weird idea was to simply inject that self-created file onto the installed floppy. And it seemed to work, just triggering another warning about an obscure but missing .config file. I had no idea what was supposed to be in there, so I just created a blank file with the same name.
Come on, never in my life is this going to work.
And how it works. Very much to my own surprise, OS2 booted up just fine with these injected files, and voila, I had high-res graphics mode. I then went on to try all possible combinations, filling in all the missing file names. Hence I created a pre-inst batch file, which should be run before the actual setup program, so it could inject the files up front into the COS2 install directory. And guess what, it works and properly installs the drivers for any resolution chosen. My somewhat fixed version is available on archive.org. And finally, I'm more than happy to see both OS2 and also WinOS2, as well as the native Windows, running in high resolution graphics mode.
Now, that was a wonderful trip down memory lane, replicating my dad's original setup.
There's some subtle differences though, as our machine didn't originally feature a network card and neither a sound card. I added these already during my previous restoration video, along with a bump up to 24 MB of RAM, exactly as we had it back then. But there's still two things missing to make it complete. Besides missing a swappable hard drive caddy, my dad once brought home one of the first 1 GB hard drives, a 5 1/4 inch Quantum Bigfoot.
And maybe one day I come along an IBM PCAT 5170 to replicate once again one of our earlier family computers. How about you? Did you also do a one-to-one replica of an old setup like you once had? Share your stories in the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching, and see you again next Sunday.